sisters, and mm-hmm. father had tried desperately with the older ones to get them to go fishing, and they wouldn't, so I didn't really volunteer to go. I was taken by the lug.
Mm-hmm. And you got to like it by fours almost.
Well, it took 3 or 4 years, but I got used to it then, and now I can't leave it alone.
Yes. I suppose that you've seen startling changes over the years, Peter, in the styles of fishing and the way fishing has developed, and I want to talk about that in our chat tonight. But in those early days, what was fishing like? Was it more fun? Was it more pleasurable? Were there more fish in those days?
Oh, there's no doubt about that at all. Even if there weren't more fish, I would imagine there were more fish, but there were certainly less anglers. And it was a beautiful thing in the older days when fishing was strictly for sport. And there were the odd person, of course, at that time, who were commercially minded, even in salmon and trout fishing. But in the main, it was men like coal miners who worked down the pit all their lives, and they couldn't get a breath of fresh air until the Saturday, and maybe once a fortnight. So they in turn sort of decided to follow the outdoor life, and me being the son of a coal miner, I was taken with my father out to fish for the very bountiful trout, because I mean, you're talking about even locally in this area, in the Glasgow area, some of the finest trout fishing in Europe, and little lochs and ponds that are now devoid of fish life, full of trout 4, 5, 6 and 7 pounds. And these were easily caught at that time, because it's now a matter of, if you go down, maybe 10 people have been before you. And if there's one good fish, it's gone before you get there. Yeah. But then you were the only hunter. You arrived there unheralded and unsung, and you got the fish.
Yes. Can you remember your first catch? You've probably been asked that many times.
I do, Arthur. I remember it very well indeed, because it was that that smote me and fixed me as far as angling was concerned. And it was fishing in the River Forth, which was our sort of working man's river. It's a river that's not... They don't say much about it, but it offers a very good fishing. There's some good salmon in it and good sea trout, and at that time, pretty good fishing. And I'd been fishing with my father at, 7:15 in the morning, having got the early train from Kirkintilloch, which is now off as well. And this was a wonderful wee thing, a wee puffer. It used to leave Kirkintilloch and go right, left Glasgow in fact, and it puffed up the line, this little puffer with two coaches right through Blainfield, and changed at Blainfield for Aberfoyle. And it was wonderful, this little thing going across Spanders Moss and Bacliaga, because you could see the reels disappearing under the wheels as it sank down. And the bloke always hesitated just a little as he passed the pool we called the salmon pool, and the anglers jumped off bag and so on. So that particular morning, I had hooked the first big fish that I ever hooked. I was only 6 years old.
Mm-hmm.
It turned out to be what would have been a British record perch. It must have been 6 pounds, but I didn't know what it was. All I knew was it was a heavy fish, very hard to land, and I roared up to the top of the pool shouting to my father, "I've caught a salmon," but it's got a bloody great gate on its back with spikes on. I didn't know what it was, but it was a 6 pound perch.
And that was you literally hooked?
Well, when you get hold of something you can't put in the water, that's you hooked.
Yeah. Well, I asked you to bring some music with you, Peter, and to choose some songs that you like, and I see that we've got Perry Como, The Carpenters, Frank Sinatra, Jack Jones. It's the kind of music I can assure you that the regular Saturday nighters are going to enjoy, but I can't help smiling at your first choice. I'm sure this has to be really your signature tune, but I'm going to let you introduce it.
Well, it's one of my favourite tenors too, Peter Marlin singing this. I was rather surprised, because I had a visit from Peter when he was doing this little thing, and he was half rehearsing in my house. It was beautiful to listen to him, because if you haven't heard a natural tenor, he really haven't heard a natural tenor until you hear Peter Marlin.
Mm-hmm.
He stood at my fireplace with his hand up the wall and said, "Well, I've had a nice supper, I'm going to sing for it now." And he sang the fishing song. I loved it.
When the countryside calls you to river and stream, and your thoughts turn to freedom but end in a dream, step off the treadmill, abandon the race, fishing is good for you. Fishing is good, fishing is good, fishing is good for you. Is good for you. So pick up a rod and a spare reel or two, some line and some fly, some silver and blue, and the old Evan minnow can't miss in a spate. Fishing is good for you. Fishing is good, fishing is good, fishing is good for you. Fishing is good for you.
to the rivers and lakes and canals for the pike. No car parking problems, just take an old bike. Pack a few sandwiches, tea in a flask. Fishing is good for you. Fishing is good, fishing is good, fishing is good for you. Everyone should get in the mood. Fishing is good for you. They're spinning and trawling and fly fishing styles and float fishing, boat fishing, matching the wiles of the fresh silver darlings who play hard to get. Fishing is good for you. Fishing is good, fishing is good, fishing is good for you. Everyone should get in the mood. Fishing is good for you. There's sturgeon and bream and there's pike, perch and roach, and cellar the salmon you're told not to poach. And sea fish and flat fishing's good for the soul. Fishing is good for you. Fishing is good, fishing is good, fishing is good for you. Everyone should get in the mood. Fishing is good for you. Then the sun disappears and you're casting our makes. You tangle your line, but you still got the breaks. Some fish in your basket, a story as well. Not the big one that got away.
Peter Mallon there with the fishing song, an appropriate first choice for my guest tonight, Peter Anderson. Peter, how in fact did your career develop when you left school? Obviously you had the inbuilt love of fishing, but had you an opportunity to exercise that love after you left school, because you've been involved then with the business of making a living and doing other things?
Oh, this is right, Arthur. When I left school, I was 16 years old and I started off as an engineer with Mabon Coulson's, and I worked on until I was called up to the Royal Air Force. I was 18 and a half years old. This was 1945, and I didn't have much chance then to follow on to what I was intending to do, and that was in fact to get into the fishing tackle trade. I always had the interest of rods and reels and so on, but I went to the RAF, and in the Royal Air Force I had the opportunity of doing exactly what I wanted to do at home, because I was based on the Thames at Marlow, and a lot of big fish in the Thames, not the kind of fish I wanted, but even so I could seek out and catch big Thames trout. I caught trout up to 5 and 6 pounds in Marlow at that time. I was able to do more of what I had intended doing at home because I had more time to do it. You know, I worked as a physical training instructor, and this only took a couple of hours a day, and the rest of the time I was fishing.
Not too bad.
It was enjoyable. And from there, I mean, I left back from the Royal Air Force, finished my time, and I went down the pits as a mechanical and electrical engineer, working on pit maintenance and so on. And I loved that. I loved it a lot, because when you've met men down a pit, you've met, as far as I'm concerned, the salt of the earth. These men live and die daily, and these men are like men, I suppose, in all the dangerous jobs. They're nearer to God than I, by far. And talking to these men made me even more certain that an outdoor life was the life to follow, and that's exactly what I did do. I left the pits and started off.
I can say, because obviously you've had an interest over the years in designing things and applying new materials and so on, because I think that about that time you began to get involved in that kind of thing, didn't you?
Well, this is right, because to replace steel in a colliery where it was heavy and cumbersome and easily damaged, we were developing fiberglass and treated silicone finishes on fiberglass, making them friction free and so on. So I'd worked at lots of these things and worked with companies making fiberglass. And when I came home one night, I had seen a little tiny a rod in the hands of a young man made of solid fiberglass. I'd never seen one before. So I thought there must be, surely, a tremendous market in the manufacture of glass rods. And it was then that a friend of mine in Glasgow put me in touch with Millar brothers, who are the biggest tackle makers in Scotland and one of the biggest in Britain. And they fell for me immediately because they were making Kane and Greenheart rods that had, they really had their day because of breakages and shortage of cane. You know, after the war, you couldn't get Tonkin cane to make cane rods. So I redesigned most of all the rods in first solid glass, which was ground to a tapered finish, which was easy. And then later on, winding around mandrels, tubular glass sections, which have improved so much now that we have, in fact, I think, the final answer, as far as I'm concerned.
Right, I want to talk about that design in a little more detail, Peter, but let's have some more music and something coming up, I see, by Perry Como.
Yeah, my favourite singer.
Right, what's he going to sing for us tonight?
He's going to sing The Very Thought of You.
The little ordinary things that everyone ought to do. I'm living in a kind of daydream. I'm happy as a king. To me, that's everything. The mere idea of you, the longing here for you, you'll never know. If I meet you, I see your face in every flower. You rise in stars above. And just to follow you, the very thought of you.
Thought of You, written by Ray Noble, of course, sung by Perry Como from his wonderful album The Best of British. I suspect that one took you back a year or two, Peter, as it did me. But
that
there's no substitute for that kind of quality, though,
no,
is there?
Vintage champagne.
Yeah, absolutely marvellous. You mentioned there the designing of fishing rods, which does interest me, because I suspect with the war intervening that there probably hadn't been much done in the way of designing rods since really the 30s right through to the late 40s.
I think this is true too, Arthur. I think the main thing, of course, is like all men, anglers are difficult to change. And until you can change your man's brain, you can't change his fishing tackle, because they still lean towards greenheart and wood rods, split cane, which only went out because of the very high cost and the possibility of getting good cane. And men still use cane rods extensively, but it was held back by the war naturally. There's no chance of changing it, and there's no need to change it, because as I say, you can go back to the old days when a greenheart rod was the thing, and it's still as good today as it was then, except that it might break. That's why we went to the new design of much tougher, much lighter, much easier to use rods.
I suspect in many ways that the fishing rod business is a bit like the golf club business. You know, there's a lot of money spent in marketing golf clubs as it is marketing fishing rods. But how important is that relative to the skill of the person? What are the proportions? Will a good fisherman still catch a good fish with a bit of string and a bent pin?
Oh yes, this is so, because, I mean, it depends largely on where you're fishing. If I'm fishing with you and your lord, Arthur Montford, with a huge stretch of the Dee, and I come fishing with you in the month of May, I might catch 70 salmon. But then somebody says to me, "Ah, you're a smart ass, you are, fishing with Lord Montford up in his lovely bit of water. I'm going to catch some for me in the Clyde." You go to the Clyde then, where the trout spend their whole day buried under a stone in case somebody catches them. Then you try and make Peter Anderson, the great angler, catch this trout. It's an entirely different story. Yeah. Then the extreme skills are necessary. The good tackle is the ultimate. You must have the right thing and do the right thing when the fish are hardest to catch. So this is not a bit of fun. It's really true that there are times when fish literally give themselves up. But the important time is when you cannot catch them. And this is when the man who is good or better than the other succeeds best.
That really, in essence, is the whole challenge of fishing, really. What you're saying.
Well, that's what it is. If you go and film, you might as well go up to S.L. Neame in Glasgow and buy your fish if you just want to take fish home. But you want to enjoy chasing them and even enjoy the failure of not getting them. Yeah. You've got to have the love of angling. I mean, angling's not just going after fish. I mean, you like to hear the birds sing, you like to hear the ripple of the water, you like to bathe your feet if you're hot, you can swim if it's too hot. You meet people and talk to people, because Burns said at one time it was a great leveller. He talked about angling in one of his wee bits of works, and it said that it was one of the greatest levellers there was, because you met policemen and lawyers and doctors, even people he didn't like, and you could talk to them in the river. Yeah. And I meet doctors and lawyers and judges and all sorts of people on the water, and these people are very ordinary, although you don't meet them in the peasants' water, you know, like sort of the Clyde and so on. You meet the finest men there, but not the highest other men. You meet them on the Dee and the Don and the Beveron, as they say, and the Spey and so on, where they pay maybe £1,000 a week for a bit of salmon fishing. But it doesn't change them, because even though it's costing them £1,000, they're still pretty ordinary people. They have a little more money, but they're just the same as you and I.
And the pleasure is the same, whether it's on the Clyde or wherever.
I think that's absolutely true. It doesn't matter where you go fishing, it's just being out, it's a way of life.
Yes. I want to talk a bit about fishing in the United States, which I know has played a very significant part in your career, your professional career, Peter. But before we do that, I think we're going to have some more music from the Carpenters, aren't we?
Yes, and we have Yesterday Once More by the Carpenters.
When I was young, I'd listen to the radio, waiting for my favorite songs. When they played, I'd sing along. It made me smile. Those were such happy times, and not so long ago. How I wondered where they'd gone. But they're back again, just like a long lost friend. All the songs I love so well. Every sha-la-la-la, every whoa-whoa still shines. Every shing-a-ling-a-ling that they're starting to sing so fine. Yesterday once more.
She made a light of day. looking back on how it was in years gone by, and the good time that I had makes today seem rather sad. So much has changed. It was songs of love that I would sing to them, and I'd memorize each word. Those old melodies still sound so good to me as they melt the years away. Every sha-la-la-la, every whoa-whoa still shines. Every shame
keep a heart beating. Give blood, give life. Call in at the Blood Transfusion Service, 80 St. Vincent Street, Glasgow. Without your help...
Have a good night on Radio Clyde.
And welcome back from me, Arthur Montfort, to the next part of Saturday Meeting Place. Reminding you that my guest tonight is fisherman Peter Anderson. Peter, I know that you've spent a great deal of time in recent years in the United States, and from what I gather, they seem to be tremendous enthusiasts for fishing over there, because I suppose there are so many of them.
This is very true, and plus the fact that they've sort of wiped out their natural heritages faster than we have, we tail on to the States. As the States does it, I see it happening here 5 or 6 years later. And they've ruined what they did have. I mean, they've got chemical plants and factories and over-netting stations and so on, where they wiped out most of the environmental enjoyment in the way of angling and in hunting. And they're now trying to recuperate and bring this back, which will happen in this country as well. But it's wonderful, because what you do have there is, in America, packing out as a way of life, weekends, a little spinning rod, a little fly rod, the car or a camper trailer, and they go north as far as they can. I mean, where they have a big complex of houses and people, it's very difficult to find an outback now, but they find it. And they go up the country as far as they can go and do a bit of fishing. And when I went there, I was overwhelmed by, in one example, the fishing in a pool in San Francisco at the Cow Palace, where they attract maybe 1 million people in 10 days. A massive show. They have a big vacation land. They have the Peter Anderson Royal Casting pool with the Queen and Prince Philip stamped in gold and red above the pool. And I'm the third member of royalty. I'm the one that's teaching them how to fly. And this happened for 5 or 6 or 7 straight years, with about 1 million people coming through. You can hardly handle them. And the people you meet, wardens of prisons, lawyers, doctors, a whole lot, all dedicated anglers seeking to come to Scotland to fish for salmon in Scotland, because they don't have it there. It's gone.
You were telling me just before we came back on the air and during that break that one of the most popular television programs is a Sunday afternoon show which features the former United States Open golf champion, Julian Boris.
Julius Boris is a very fine man, a lovely man. I mean, he's like Jack Hargreaves in this country on TV, except maybe that he's if anything, more dedicated to angling than general outdoor life, and he loves angling. I mean, he said this to me when I was there the first year, 12 or 14 years ago, you know, if I could have spent my life in angling, I would have done so, even for much less reward. But his program on a Sunday is something to see, because if you love outdoor life and beauty, you have it there, because they give you all the scenic beauty of Colorado and right up into Labrador and so on. And it shows Julius at the best all the time, teaching little laddies how to enjoy fishing. Not so much how to fish, because he's not really a technical man in angling. But he loves to. The program starts so beautifully with him walking down a little pathway near his home, and he meets a wee boy with a bit of string and a bit of wood and a bow in his hand, and says, "Come on, sonny, I'm going to take you fishing." And he does for an hour and a half every Sunday, and it's watched with bated breath, with wives, daughters, husbands, everybody. They must see this program.
Clearly, though, they have a problem there, Peter, which you've observed it firsthand, the fact that so many of them want to catch fish, and there are no so few fish to catch. It seems very sad, doesn't it?
Yeah, well, it's such a big country too. I mean, when I went first and arrived in New York, first year I was there, the plane was flying over the Arctic Circle, like, and down over New York, and I'm getting ready to leave the plane. The stewardess said to me, an idiot from Kirk and Tillich, "You know, just a minute, so you're going to San Francisco, aren't you?" "Yes, well, you've the same distance to go again." Well, I didn't know that. So we flew for another 4 or 5 hours from New York right over to San Francisco, and I realized then the immense size of the states. So they have this enormous proportion of land to cover to get anywhere. And they have this huge problem of money. And it's the same in this country now. Chemical plants have ruined all the fishing. I mean, there's mercury poisoning in various rivers in Lake St. Clair from Canada into America. There's also the pollution caused by people. Lake Michigan in Chicago was a great problem 10 years ago when I was there. It probably still is. Because when you flew over Lake Michigan from Detroit back to Chicago, it took an hour by jet to come over the lake diagonally. And coming over, you see this beautiful blue eye in the center, and a brown mess around the extremities of this huge lake, which was people, pollution, sewage, and so on. So they brought that back. They brought in coho salmon. They've introduced coho salmon. They're fishing very successfully in the middle of Chicago, in the Chicago River. And then this will happen. They'll get it back, because it'll take a lot of money. But they've got the money.
But I want to talk about that problem in this country, in Wisconsin in particular. But before we do that, coming up now, I see, is one of your favourite singers, Frank Sinatra.
I think one of the finest that ever sang, Francis Albert himself.
And what's he going to do for us tonight?
Well, it's like, it's one of my favourite songs all the way.
When somebody loves you, it's no good unless he loves you. Oh, happy to be near you when you need someone to cheer you all the way. Taller than the tallest trees, that's how it's got to be. Deeper than the deep, that's how deep it goes. If it's real, when somebody needs you, it's no good unless he needs you all the way. Through the good or lean years, and for all the in-between, come what may, who knows where the road will lead us? Only a fool would say. But if you let me love you, it's for sure I'm gonna love you all the way. All the way.
Sinatra. Peter, you mentioned your fears for Scotland's fishing in Scotland's waters, and how justifiable are those fears in the present situation?
It's obvious when you see what's happening now, Arthur, because I travel the country extensively, all the time fishing, and I find most of the better waters are being sold and taken over by people that don't intend to allow day anglers or weekly anglers. The problem of pollution or water extraction isn't quite so severe, although it is a problem because a higher water wrecked a lot of fish salmon rivers. There's no doubt about that at all. They deny this, but they have done. Forestation, which I don't understand at all, because I'm told that the trees are no use to anyone. Some people said they're made to go into for pit props. Well, they use mechanical pit props and hydraulic pit props mainly. They said they make good paper. I now hear it doesn't make good paper at all. They import ores or timber to make paper. So we now have trees. Virtually one little Highland man said to me last year, "Christ, you better not stand still too long. Here they'll plant a tree on top of your head." Right, this is so. And people don't realise that every tree's sucking up every drop of precious water that's needed to fly it down the river and bring fish in, especially salmon and sea trout. We now have rivers are all shadows of their former self. We're losing the water. You lose the water. Nothing worse than losing the water. It doesn't matter about the fish. The fish come up to that river and they go up to pools that used to be 12 feet deep, they're now 12 inches deep. These fish are easily poached out, taken out, killed or died. And in this way we're wiping out what we're already used to try to protect all our lives. And selling out what's best in the way of the Spey and the Dee and the main rivers, we're making it impossible for our people, our own people at home here, to get a bit of fishing when they want it. It's either far too costly or it's just not obtainable.
And so much of it now is owned by Europeans.
Well, we have this terrible problem now where the biggest spend of my father said it's going to be the land of the almighty dollar. This is already proven so. My father's now dead. He was the finest angler in our country. He fished all his life and he was very wise. And he said to me, "You mustn't let this happen, but there's nothing I can do about it." Mm-hmm. So we could do something about it, because it's unfair that a man should buy so much water and then stop you and I from going there. Or if we're very friendly, we get the odd day, that's fine, but suddenly we want a cousin to go, he can't go. Mm-hmm. To be fair, you've got to think for other people rather than for yourself. I mean, I've been in many places, but I still feel very strongly the fact that you couldn't go if I wanted you to go, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I think there should be a better way of conducting the sport fishing in this country. Should be a better way. There is a better way. The average angler can do a better job, perhaps, than the administration.
It's very sad, though, isn't it, to think that part of our heritage might just literally be washed away.
Well, there's a new act now, Arthur, coming through, where it's making it illegal to fish for brown trout. See, Scotland's always had this strength of allowing brown trout fishing for the people who live here.
Mm-hmm.
A natural heritage, it's gone now, because they're now bringing out the usual stupid thing, an act which is so overwhelming that it's frightening. No person will be allowed to fish for minnows, dace, roach, eels, perch, so without licence. And as soon as they do that, it means that you can't take your son. My boy, I hate to think about it, I come up to Carmsey Glen and say, "Come on, Peter, we'll go and fish for some trout, son," and take him in a little moorland stream up the hill, unless a policeman is kept away from you, because he can come and say, "Look, boy, you shouldn't be here." And he's going to lock me up, and the penalties are terrible, as they are in salmon poaching. When a man gets 2 years hard labour for poaching salmon, and in the same papers I have seen, 2 years guilty of raping somebody's grandmother getting maybe 3 years suspended sentence, or a man drunk and beating up his wife getting 30 days, or a drunken motorist killing 2 people and he's let off with a minimum sentence.
Mm-hmm.
So it's getting right almost to the stage, I think, again, where men had their hands cut off for poaching deer. It seems that life is not sacred, but sporting rights are.
It's a problem, Peter, isn't it? And I just hope that those of us who care enough for our environment can perhaps keep on trying and perhaps do something about it.
Well, it's up to you and I, Arthur, I'm sure we'll do a lot about it. Well, we should feel the same way.
Well, I certainly know that you and your colleagues will keep trying. So, Peter, to our last piece of music, and I'm greatly intrigued. This is certainly going down memory lane a little. And,
well, I'm
looking forward to hearing it.
I presume the strength of my past associations of Big Donald and Stuart Fraser and John Marshall and all the boys that I fished with in the Awe and the Orkney, and my wife particularly, because this is a record we used to sing at 2 o'clock in the morning, hurtling up the road to fish the Orkney when there's no keepers on it Sunday morning. When it wasn't an offence to fish on a Sunday because nobody cared, but now you go to prison if you fish on Sunday. And I loved fishing, and I loved fishing then, and I took the opportunity when I could. And this was our favourite song, it probably always will be.
Right, it's going to be Joseph Locke singing "My Heart and I." Peter Anderson, thank you for being my guest.
Great pleasure, Arthur, thank you.
Thank you. are in love with you, my heart and I, and we are always true, my heart and I. When you are far away, smile at me, but it's a lovely day. Love is blind, the wind touched on the road, and that my heart and I are just so cold. And that my darling, if we ever say goodbye, once in a lifetime or never, I met my fate on the day I met you. That moment I found you, I knew. Strange fascination seems to fill and hold me. Faithful temptation, such as no one ever told me. Everything I will endure for you, come what may, and I thought it's yours, so you just take it.